dream come true to think what could happen with the economic prosperity and growth that's coming our way. And it reminds me of a little story. I may have told some of you this about when I'm a Republican, so I went to the Republican National Convention. And on the way, I asked Peggy, my wife, if she ever imagined in her wildest dream that her husband would be making a nomination speech for Donald Trump for president in Cleveland, Ohio. And she said, "Henry, I hate to tell you, but I've never seen you in any of my wildest dreams." Source of power. remarkable to hear of these companies that come here and spend hundreds of millions of dollars, all delighted, and they say, every one of them that I've talked to has said, it's the people that are actually the final factor that gets them. And that's with Bosch, which has 320-something thousand employees worldwide, Schaeffler up in York County, it has about the same number of big companies. And today, Siemens, in Columbia, Siemens gave $628 million worth of software, top-of-the-line software on industrial techniques and improvements and all that to the University of South Carolina. They're partnering with them in their research capacities in order to train the workforce. That's something that nobody's seen that happen. They've done it in two other places, and this is huge. Dr. Pastini says that's the biggest one thing that has happened to the university in 100 years or something like that. But all these things are happening here. They're happening on the coast, they're happening inland, they're happening up in the mountains. And our objective, my objective, is to see that we don't mess it up. Because it can be messed up. It can be knocked off track by high taxes, by too many regulations, by having to drive all over creation to get permits, to get to work. And that's something that I've heard every one of these meetings we've had so far in the state. So that we really do, we have it all. We have everything we need. The other states are looking at us. They know they can't catch us. Our technical college system started in 1961. That's when Radio SC started as well. Nobody can catch up with that. We've got all these things built and ready to go. All we need to do is have a big vision and realize that now is the time for us to accelerate and get ahead of the competition. We've got to stay competitive. And right now, the way to do that is through this high-tech training where you have long-distance truck drivers that can make $100,000 a year if you have that associate career from the technical college. You have nuclear welders that can make $125,000 a year. Aeronautical technicians, like the ones that work on your state plane that I flew down here, they average $75,000 a year. Those are good jobs. But a lot of these did not exist years ago. And we have a cultural challenge to explain to the parents as well as the young people that these jobs are real good jobs. You can be buying a house at 22 years old with very little debt from college, go to that technical school. If you want to go to your four-year college later, most of the time those things will transfer and you can finish up later if you want to. But it's a new world out there. And in several of these plants I've been to, where they have huge machinery, all sorts of robots, very expensive machinery. The man said to me, our maintenance technicians don't have toolboxes anymore. They have laptops. That's how it's changed. Our cities have changed. You've seen Greenville change. You've seen this coast change. People are coming here. Droves. So we are sitting on an opportunity for enormous prosperity if we don't mess it up. So what I'm trying to do is encourage these businesses, big ones, small ones, to set up, expand, stay here. And I know that the big ones, every time one of those big ones comes here, there always is a ripple effect, there's a cascade of new ideas that comes out of the research universities and big can lose it by too much, too big of regulations or unnecessary taxes. Low taxes, just the necessary regulations. If we do that, then we all would be just fine. So with that, I'd love to answer or try to respond to any questions, ideas, suggestions that anybody has.
Deborah, I'll just start by saying, I know we're here to talk about regulation, but I know I speak on behalf of the business community and residents. Thank you for taking such a swift and strong stand to help us with our challenge here in Myrtle Beach. We're going through this better off than we were before. And we know we need your help, and we appreciate you jumping in so quickly.
Well, thank you, Brad. We had a meeting we had earlier. That was an arsenal of law enforcement experience and power in the room. Everybody was left. And we have a great team. That, as I see it, the events of the other night were an aberration. I mean, this is everybody knows all across the country. It's a family beach. It's a beautiful place. Those young fellows, 17, 18 years old, part of them, most of them from North Carolina. And it was senior week or something. And they're rising seniors or graduating seniors. And they're young people. And they got way out of hand. It hurts me. But we have assembled in that room everyone who has a part in awful response. There'll be a heightened police presence. Some will be seen, others will be unseen. We've got good professional people, and I don't believe we will see that anymore. I'm afraid those young fellows from North Carolina didn't realize what kind of place this is, and they don't tolerate that. So, thank you. But I think they will get the message pretty soon.
Governor.
Yes?
I'm going to find out from SLED how they got here, because I was telling them to back road. I took it, and you got here before I did, so you must have helicoptered in or something. I apologize for being a minute late, but thank you for being here today. Twofold question. One is listening to you speak at the last event. We talked about a lot of manufacturing things, and you continue to talk about the asset that we have here in Orion County, which is our beaches. And it is the number one industry, in our belief, in the state of South Carolina, and we need to protect that. Through Duane Parrish and others, they have tremendously helped us through Hurricane Matthew. But what we really need is we need dedicated beach renourishment funding. So we don't have to come every time there's a beach renourishment with our agreement with the Corps of Engineers, that we have to come hat in hand and beg for participation from the state of South Carolina to help us. We need to figure out a way collaboratively to get some dedicated funding that we know it is continually there to support these beaches. And on the other question, twofold question is, we keep talking about all the industry that's in the upstate and other parts of the state. We're an up-and-comer. Our Economic Development Corporation is alive and well. Our county council just made a tremendous effort in continuing our 1.5 cent hospitality fee, which is going to give us $400 million towards I-73, which Congressman Rice and Alan Clemens and Brad Dean and all the others that are in the room that helped so much, and the state of South Carolina that helped us to get that permit for I-73. We now have real skin in the game. We have our own railroad that is operating that can tie into CSX. So we've got all the parts in place. We're just going to need a little help, and Bobby Hitt and the Commerce Department have been tremendous to us, but we're going to need that continued effort and continued help from the state of South Carolina. And I think everybody in this room just wants to hear the commitment from you and your staff that's you know where we're headed, and that the commitment is there to help us as we move along.
Yes, the way. It is that. And on the beach risk renourishment, that's a subject that comes up all along the coast, and I think you're right. I think the beaches are a state asset, and the responsibility for maintaining them should be spread not just among those near the coast, but it is a state asset. It ought to be a deep and broad responsibility. But I have to figure out how far that goes, how much who bears what. But I agree with you.
Thank
pay bill in next year and next session, and hopefully we can get that through the House next year. I know you supported in the past, and I hope we can, Kimberly, you can support that next year.
That's right, government needs to move quickly, need to have quick decisions on things. That was listening to President Trump talk, he had some figures on how much money is lost just by the delay and the delay in getting permits and getting decisions, and it's a large part of the expense of a lot of infrastructure and other things. And I believe that too, I think we've all learned that over the years. So we're working on that, and that's a part of this effort to see which regulations are slowing us down, which laws are slowing us down, and see what we can do to fix it. Okay. I need to call on somebody.
I'll add a few things.
Volunteer.
My name is Sheila Fletcher. I'm with Carolina Country Music Festival. And first, we'd like to say thank you so much for the hospitality that we have. Support from your office, Senator Rankin, House Member Rye. We are hopefully making this music festival a home here in Myrtle Beach. We've got a little bit of legislation with the DOR that I think we're going to work through this year. And we just ask for all the support of the community and all of you guys and the governor's office to help us keep this festival here. We do a little over 32,000 people a day. We look at it as home, and we really want to be a part, and we appreciate you as the governor supporting travel and tourism here in Myrtle Beach. It's a heartfelt place for me. I love it. Thank you.
The Costa Leto is worldwide. It's world famous. I think we have a lot of things like that. Music and art and all those things, that's another part of that. I'd like to see our film industry expand. There are a lot of things I'd like to see like that, and I agree with you 100%.
Got a question right here?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm here in Jeff Carroll on North Beach City Council. This issue is related to the tourism business, and that is our heroin opioid epidemic. And we are finding the city of Myrtle Beach that we could take people out of jail and put them into treatment facilities, but we don't have treatment. It really is connected to our tourism industry when we find these drug addicted people down on our boulevard and on our boardwalk. We have nothing to do with it. What can the state do to help us get funds for treatment beds for these people who are suffering from this disease?
Well, that's a good question. I know good swift law enforcement is always a good response to those kind of things. But this epidemic is really constraining us. It's bigger than that. I'd like to hear some ideas from you or some others in the room. There never will be enough money. One problem. There never will be enough money.
The idea of policing ourselves out of this problem is not going to work over because it is a disease. On the national level, that's the discussion. And the way you do it is you need the treatment beds, and then you need ongoing treatment. It's not going to take a lot of money to get us out of it, but we're going to have the beds for treatment and the kind of counseling and treatment that's going to be needed. We have to have that from the state.
But it does cost money.
Does cost money.
And there's one thing I've learned is that we will never have enough to do everything we want to do. We have to prioritize, we have to cut something out. Like the blanket is too small on the bed, you put it to this side, this guy's uncovered.
But with respect, Governor, it's cheaper to treat people who are addicted than to put them in jail.
I understand.
So we move the money around, it might be more effective.
I understand. And that's such a simple question, I'll ask Mr. Clemens to get up and tell us.
I'm burned.
I'm open to ideas.
There was in the budget this year, I know you were up on that. The government, of course, signed that, but there was $1.5 million that was coordinated through MUSC for treatment and to go to the areas most affected. And it was kind of indigent treatment for those that didn't have insurance. So that's a good start.
It's a big problem. It's a challenge, but I think we have the people, we have the assets to meet most any challenge. We're gonna have to prioritize. Be very careful. Yes.
I'll bring up.
Hello, Mary.
Hey, Mary. They don't know how far back we've been, you know. Carrie knows I've been through 6 lieutenant governors now on the Council on Aging, and there is legislation now to make the Council on Aging a cabinet level office. Our chambers have done such a wonderful job in getting tourists to come here, then they move here. South Carolina is not prepared with nursing home beds, Meals on Wheels, and things like that to keep our seniors aging in place. But now that we are elevating it, hopefully with the legislation passing, to a cabinet level agency, can you explain a little bit so people know in case they get asked about how that's gonna work as we move things into one agency and try to consolidate services? We're redoing a website, which I think is gonna help a whole lot, but you helped start that with Lynn McConnell.
Right. Well, we have, Lynn McConnell used to refer to it as a
Gracie Nunn.
That's the title where all the baby boomers are getting retirement age, and that the whole story, all coming at one time. We're not set up for it. But what we must do, like other situations, is we need a good information system where people can find out which assets are where and how, who to call and all those kind of things. And we have a website now that is not adequate for what's coming. And you know that the children and friends and neighbors can access that to find out what to do with the lady next door or mama or dad. There have been a lot of cultural shifts. And one of them is everybody can drive a car and people are going all over the country. Nobody's home anymore. Mom and dad are there by themselves. And so that's one thing that's changed. The baby boom is another thing that's coming. But fortunately, all this nano technology and the communication and all that's what we call that fourth industrial revolution that we're in the middle of now can accommodate a lot of those needs by just spreading information and allowing contact. But one thing that I've really managed, again, is volunteerism, because there never will be enough money. But it is an organization here in Myrtle Beach that has it's a ride program.
Neighbor to neighbor.
That's an excellent thing. I was working to get that spread around the state. They were very cooperative, and we made some progress. There's a similar one in Charleston. But the idea there is to have people volunteer who are trained and know how to handle these older people who may have certain limitations, and they volunteer for certain times during the day or during the week to put on the big board, so to speak, and then you have the people calling who need right. If people know that they can go someplace when they need to go, that takes a lot of pressure off. It makes it a lot easier to stay at home. I don't have the figures in my head right now, but the cost of putting someone in a nursing home with that kind of care is something like 10 or 20 times more than having somebody go by to visit and do a few simple things if they stay at home. We're going to have to go in that direction because there's not enough money. I repeat, there will never be enough money to provide government services to take care of everybody in our elderly population. And the more you get people out, the more they keep visiting and seeing people, then they do a lot about it. So that's an area. Now, what we want to do is make that a cabinet agency, mainly to give it the status and recognition that it needs. The way I had it envisioned, it cost me more money, but it would be in a position to be more influential in these affairs. But that tsunami's coming, and we got to get ready. I'm not real sure, but I think everybody in this room has gotten about 30 minutes older since I've been here. Can't stop the clock. Thank you for bringing that up. More? Brad?
Yeah, Governor, how about permitting for a minute? We've seen a that case, at the state in general. But one of the challenges is, I think, navigating a process where it's multi-agency responsibilities and those handoffs that aren't always efficient and effective. I think there might be an idea that wouldn't cost us any money, but maybe some sort of, for lack of a better term, blue ribbon task force that includes private sector individuals, engineers, and architects that have gone through the permitting. It could maybe help look at that process from the outside looking in, and maybe look at some handoffs that could be more efficient or interagency coordination. It doesn't take any more people, might actually save some jobs, but more importantly, I think what it would do is to help improve some of the efficiencies in coordination. If you're going through that permit process with DNR, DHEC, DOT, whoever might be involved, not that we don't have permits, but to actually look at how to make that a little more efficient, or at least shorten the time cycle, so maybe we're not waiting on each agency, but rather they're working in a coordinated fashion. We noticed when we worked with Dwayne, he's an arm's length of what is a government, because he'll not only do what PRT needs to do, he'll point you to the right people within those other agencies. Out of that, I think there might be an opportunity to look at, do we absorb some of the federal permitting responsibilities? I know that's a much bigger argument, a bigger discussion, but I think New Jersey and other states have looked at possibly taking some of that on. There's a cost to do that, but I think we also find some private developers on the coast that would gladly invest in that process if we could speed it up and make it more efficient. Not looking for more money or more people, just speeding up the process and making it a little more efficient for the private sector.
Well, that's a good observation, and a lot of things we do better can cost any money. You just have to think it through. So that point about business licenses was raised in vivid belief in one of these recent meetings where there's a man that has businesses in South Carolina and Georgia. And he said in South Carolina, his whole entire one wall in his office is festooned with business licenses from every city and county and every municipal organization under the sun. And he's got one business license in Georgia. And we found that that's first I heard of that. So we will see what they're doing. But then there's a question of where the money goes and how much of it comes back to the state. And I understand that there's a debate in the General Assembly about whether the Secretary of State, if we develop such a system, whether it should be centralized with the Secretary of State, or whether the business association, municipal association, should handle it. I don't have the answers to those questions, but yes, I think that politics and government, in essence, is a hunt for good ideas, and they are out there. And I think that's a real good one. A lot of times we don't know what's going on in other states, but I'm trying to look around as much as we can and find out what other people are doing. Use we can steal from them and use it. Yes?
Hey, Governor McMaster, I'm Greg Duckworth. I live in North Myrtle Beach. I also in the House of Representatives for North Myrtle and Little River and other parks. 2 days ago, I was in John McGill's office up there in Columbia. He's, of course, the director of the Department of Mental Health. We're just kind of shooting the breeze like this, trying to come up with ideas. And I like what you said just a moment ago in reference to, trying to lower the cost of, our aging population in reference to, is the cost 10 to 20 times more to keep somebody in a nursing home? I was shocked to find out that the Department of Mental Health has the responsibility, if I'm not mistaken, for 3, maybe 4 retirement home facilities under their jurisdiction. I'm thinking, is there a way to take the burden of that kind of care away from the Department of Mental Health and put those revenues that are so important for South Carolina for mental health care and shift that burden away? That's just a question and a thought.
That's a good question. That point has come up. Where there's a will, there's a way. I don't know exactly what course to take or what the process is, but you're correct. That's another one we're trying to stay.
They
get an answer to. Anybody else got any questions, suggestions, or ideas? Well, let me say I've enjoyed it. I'll be back. I've been coming to Myrtle Beach and the Grand Strand and Pawleys Island and Myrtle's Inlet and all. I remember going to Georgetown.